In this video, I want to say something about wiring diagrams and the mathematical way that we tend to represent circuits. I will also talk about the difference between a good wiring diagram and a bad wiring diagram. First of all, I want to describe the difference between a wire that we draw in a circuit schematic and a real wire, like a copper wire that we use in an actual circuit. You see, in a schematic, when we draw a wire or a line, what we mean is that the voltage everywhere along this wire is the same. However, in a real wire, that's not going to be the case. For example, if I have a very long wire hooked up to a voltage source where the negative side is connected to the ground and the positive side is at 10 volts, if we attach that long wire to a resistor R, then in a real wire, the voltage might drop a little bit because of some resistance in the wire itself. But that's the difference between a long wire in the lab and the wiring diagram, because mathematically, when we write the wire on the schematic, we really mean that we're treating it in an ideal case. There are matters other than resistance that are important too. For example, in a schematic, we assume that a signal placed at one end of the wire will appear instantaneously at the other end of the wire. That's not true in real life. There's a time delay. When you put a signal on one end of the wire, the signal travels very fast at some significant fraction of the speed of light, given how fast electrons move through metals. It certainly won't be instantaneous. If a wire is really long, then the time delay can matter in certain situations. But in circuits, it's very easy to sometimes overlook the fact that we're idealizing these wire lengths. Let me draw a few situations that are mathematically equivalent on paper, but might not be too easy to see. I've drawn a rather funny-looking circuit in the diagram to the left. Let me now simplify that circuit. I can simplify this circuit by noting that this entire section is all one wire. This is all one piece of metal. It's all at the same voltage, and it's all connected. So everything that I've just colored with the blue pen can be represented by a single dot. Everything connected to it is connected to that dot. How many resistors do we have connected to that dot? I've drawn a lot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I could redraw the circuit with those resistors placed very close together. In fact, they're all in parallel. I hope you can see now that circuit diagrams can cause circuits sometimes to look more complicated than they actually are. And it's important when looking at them to notice sometimes that things really aren't as they seem. Anything connected by a wire can be compressed down to a single dot. Now let me draw an example of a good circuit diagram and a bad circuit diagram, because there's a couple of more conventions that I think are important to know. A good wiring diagram typically has high voltages towards the top of the diagram and low voltages or the ground near the bottom of the diagram. A bad wiring diagram doesn't pay any attention to these matters. A good wiring diagram typically has signals that run left to right in the schematic, and a bad diagram might have signals that run all over the place, or power consumption that runs in circles, for example. These are all bad things to avoid. Of course, mathematically, you should always be able to decode what a circuit schematic says. But for human readability, we like to have the high voltages near the top because it just makes logical sense. So let's make a good diagram first. We also typically like to square things up. Let's make a bad version of this. There are a lot of things that are bad about the wiring diagram that I just drew, but mathematically, it's entirely identical to the diagram that I labeled as being good. What all have I done wrong? Well, first of all, I have the voltage source turned upside down. It's not good to have the lower voltages up at the top. That's bad. I've also not used straight lines. Generally, that's not neat. That's bad. Also, I've funny looking big long loopy paths that don't make any sense. In other words, my power doesn't really flow in one direction, whereas with the good diagram, the flow of power was left to right because power was supplied by the DC voltage source and power was consumed successively by resistors R1 and R2 and R3. Whereas with the bad diagram, the power flow was kind of inconsistent here. So I hope you can see now the difference between a good wiring diagram and a bad wiring diagram. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.